nice example. So with that, I would
thank you. Thank you, Jing, for an overly generous introduction. So I'll tell you today about some recent dramatic developments in our understanding of mitotic spindle. So the talk will be focused on this machine, molecular machine, mitotic spindle. And so there's a lot of interesting facts and drama associated with this structure. For example, this drawing, which shows spindle in the beginning of anaphase, when sister chromatids are starting to get pulled to opposite poles just before the cell starts physically to divide. This drawing was done more than 150 years ago on, from the image on a very primitive light microscope, and it's kind of amazing to see how faithfully tiniest molecular details got reproduced. So, for example, today's efforts to do electron microscopy tomography of the spindle give us results actually amazingly similar to what people kind of half saw, half imagined was happening. So another trivia fact, which I like, is that mitotic spindle, of course, it's not really in public imagination, and it's not a household image, but it did get into popular culture. So if you're ever in Mexico City, you should certainly look up this poster by mural by Diego Rivera called Man at Crossroads. There's actually a really fascinating story behind it. It was commissioned to Rivera by one of the Rockefellers in early 1920s. So he started to do it in New York, and this is a tiny fragment. If you look at the whole mural, there are odious figures like Lenin and Trotsky there. And when Rockefeller saw that, he totally freaked out, and the lawyers got involved, and they told, you got to destroy it. And there was a big court battle, and eventually it was destroyed. But then Rivera, just out of spite, reproduced it in Mexico City in the same way. It's fun to see the actual mural. But so why I'm telling you all this is because the very centerpiece, so this is at the very center of the mural, you can see this mitotic spindle with clocks. And so if you read archive of Rivera, he was actually thinking of something like a cell cycle. And John here, of course, did groundbreaking work on that. So Rivera was thinking that mitotic spindle is integral part of something like mitotic cycle. So Rivera didn't know much about cell science or anything. It was exactly the year that was a lot of drama between him and Frida Kahlo. So it's interesting. Anyway, so it's absolutely impossible to try to understand everything about mitotic spindle. So what I'll tell you about is the stage in life of mitotic spindle, which is perhaps the most faithful and dramatic. It's actually assembly of mitotic spindle. So simply speaking, what's happening is cell has two centrosomes instead of one when it exits interphase and goes into mitosis, and each of the centrosomes is organizing a center for microtubules that are anchored in the centrosome and growing away from the center. And the nuclear envelope, which was around the chromosomes, breaks down, and at this point, connections are made. And so the goal of the cell is to assemble the spindle where all the chromosomes are at the equator, centrosomes are at the north and south poles, and microtubules connect centrosomes to the so-called kinetochores, which are very complex molecular assemblies that are basically kind of droplets of glue connecting centrosomes to chromosomes. So each of the things I'm saying behind it is enormous molecular complexity, which is researched in great detail these days. I will talk kind of about events on a grander scale that kind of skip over individual molecular circuits and pathways and look at this whole assembly process. And in a way, there are these two hypotheses about how spindle assembles. One is centrosome-centric, another is chromosome-centric. So in the centrosome-centric story, the idea is that microtubules grow from the centrosome and find this, find the chromosomes, and that's how it happens. In chromosome-centric story, microtubules grow pretty much everywhere, and then somehow get organized by kinetochores, and then somehow get focused into the two poles where centrosomes turned out to be. And there's also a growing understanding that, in fact, what we have in generic animal cell is something, a hybrid or combined, that there are microtubules looking for chromosomes, but what they're finding is actually microtubule bundles growing from the kinetochores, and somehow this connection is made. So we started about 15 years ago to think about the first part of this story. We didn't think about microtubules coming from the kinetochores, but we thought about this qualitative picture, which was suggested by Michison and Kirshner. And this suggestion was a search and capture hypothesis, which came from the experimental discovery of dynamic instability. So it's a very beautiful process in which microtubules rapidly and repeatedly grow and shrink, and so go through this multiple cycles of growth and shrinking. And the idea was very simple and beautiful, that chromosome just hangs out somewhere there and just keeps waiting for some microtubules to randomly grow in the right direction, bump into the kinetochore, and make a connection. So there's this cycles of search and then capture. So then, of course, people almost immediately realized that one of the problems that will be happening is that, so the desired sequence is that first a monotelic connection is made, right? You capture one of the kinetochores from one pole, then another kinetochore is captured from another pole, and that's what you have, amphitelic attachment. But of course, one can easily imagine that there will be a lot of errors. For example, you capture both kinetochores from the same pole, or even worse, you capture one of the kinetochore from opposite poles. And Daniela Cimini, who is here, did some pioneering studies of that. And one of the results of those studies was that there's actually amazingly few of those errors. In fact, the cell makes quite a number of errors transiently and then corrects them. And that's kind of another story, how it happens. But still, what is a little bit shocking is that even this transient number of errors is very little. There are basically a few percent of those errors transiently. In the end, there's like one error per about 1,000 or 10,000 cells. So the accuracy is absolutely shocking. So one of the first questions about this was not the errors, but a simple question like how much time does it take to assemble spindle with this in this random way. And the groundbreaking work, which was kind of not even pen and paper, it was what is called back of the envelope estimate, was done by Holly and Leibler about 25 years ago. They simply considered one kinetochore as a target and one microtubule doing this search and estimated the time needed to make a connection. And the time turned out to be about 10 to 30 minutes, which is exactly the time many generic animal cells take. So that supported the search and capture idea. So what we did about a decade after this Hoyland Weber work, we decided not to do it on paper, but actually to mimic the process, which conceptually is extremely trivial computational undertaking. You simply put chromosomes wherever they are, start mimicking microtubule dynamic instability, do what is called Monte Carlo simulation, very simple. And then it's basically the same experiment, but done not in vivo, but in silico on the computer. So one of the interesting results here was that if you do it this way, the spindle assembly takes actually order of magnitude longer than predicted from a simple initial Hoyland-Weber model. And the reason is relatively trivial. One reason is that the cell have to wait for all the kinetochores to get captured. And it's as simple as if average time to capture kinetochore is tau, and then there's n kinetochores, then using relatively trivial probability theory, you can estimate that the time to capture all of them goes up as logarithm of n. And so you have a few tens, and you multiply everything by about factor of five, right? And another factor of two or three or four is geometric. There are so many chromosomes that it's really hard to get to some of the kinetochores. So that's one of the things. Another thing, if you look at the histogram of times when the capture is made, you see that majority of the kinetochores are captured at certain time. But then it's really increasingly hard to get the last ones, right? So you have to wait for this fat tail of the distribution, which is probably cells in real life are not going to do. It's too, it's just from design principles point of view, it's not a good idea to do that.
In this case, do you allow the microtubule to penetrate through the
chromosome? No, that's a great question. This is actually a kind of open question experimentally. In the model, we made the chromosome arms impenetrable. In real life, microtubules kind of can go through them and spearhead them. So, but this is one of the interesting factors.
Alex, is that the capture time for one chromosome?
So this is histogram. So they all are captured here. This is the histogram of like the number of captured within this time interval, and this is the result of hundreds of the numerical experiments.
Okay. So with 46 chromosomes, it takes?
It takes like 500 minutes. But this is in this primitive model. I'll show you the next slide what's going to happen. So another problem with that this model predicts is that if you just do it without any error correction, pretty much all connections you're making are meratelic. And this is very easy to understand without math. Basically, if you do it long enough, you first do this, but then if you wait it long enough, then this happens in the end, right? So so it just tells you that cells have to keep repairing the errors. But the problem here is that nobody believes that pretty much all the connections at some point are erroneous.
And meratelic are the hardest ones to spot.
The hardest ones, right. So syntelic attachments, there are some basic mechanisms to repair them very easily. But meratelic are murderous. There's common belief that that's kind of pathway to cancer, and they're extremely rare. But there's also data from, for example, from Daniela Cimini, it's in our joint paper, that meratelic attachments are actually often not corrected. Cell doesn't know how to correct them. So the cell, of course, does a lot of tricks to both accelerate the assembly of the spindle and make it more accurate. So the ways to accelerate is one, there's some biochemical ways to redirect all the microtubules inside the former nuclear volume rather than search uselessly away from former nucleus. There's also this very simple fact that if you start shuffling chromosomes around, it's much easier to assemble the spindle because some chromosomes, which otherwise would be very hard to capture, at some point they get very close to some of the centrosomes and connections are made. But this also, of course, it's easy to imagine, it also increases the number of errors a lot, right, theoretically speaking. And then our most recent study was looking at the following facts, that one of the exciting experimental developments was that kinetochores, which always were thought to be these really tiny buttons that are very hard to capture, they're in fact dynamic, and they're big and puffy in the beginning of the perimeter phase when the spindle was assembling. And then they get tiny at the end. And there's also a growing number of studies showing that kinetochores get condensed when the actual capture occurs. I will get back to it at the end of the talk. And so what when we did this Monte Carlo simulation with these dynamic changes, there was a really interesting thing that got us excited, that you can at the same time accelerate assembly. But that's kind of an easy fact. You get targets bigger, so of course you capture them faster. But you also can decrease the number of errors. And why you decrease the number of errors is because when you capture first time, you turn the chromosome in such a way that one kinetochore faces one pole and another pole. So that's kind of the explanation. But so about 5 years ago, what we were feeling that we are bumping against a wall. And this wall is that we can get the assembly time with all these tricks down from 500 minutes to like to 5-10 minutes, which is great. But only if we push the parameters of the model really in the tiny corner of the parameter space, which is also always a suspicion. It means something is quite wrong. So this is not robust. You can only do it if parameters are just so. Another thing is that there's no way to get percentage of error below something like 20%, which is still an enormous number for physiology. So we kind of started to get disillusioned with this whole search and capture business. And of course, at that point, it became clear that we cannot proceed without a completely different set of data, which goes beyond what people did before. And so the whole story I'm going to tell you, it's basically based on the data revolution that is happening now, that quantitative data is becoming cheap, available, and there's no way to proceed forward without incorporating this big data into the model. So this type of data that is coming from the lab of our collaborator conceptually is very simple. So what our collaborators do, they simply track the centrosomes. This connection is simply for visualization. And all the kinetochores, so like this, see the sister kinetochores connected by the deformable centromere in 3D. And spatial resolution is something like 0.3 microns, and time resolution, there's image every 5 seconds. So it's enormous volumes of data. And of course, technical challenges there are very big. The main challenge is that to avoid photo damage of the cell when you collect so much microscopy data. And so we finally got this from tens of cells under different chemical conditions. And so for about a year, we tried to understand this data. So when we stared at the data, you can notice some interesting things about it, but we realized at some point that just staring at it, we can't do it. So then we tried machine learning, which is all the rage now. We chose some of the trajectories of the chromosomes where we thought we understand what's going on, told our deep learning network that those trajectories means this and those trajectories mean that, and then fed it all the trajectories. And then it gave us some results, but it was complete garbage. We couldn't understand. I mean, it maybe was telling us something, but we didn't understand what it was telling us. And the progress started when we realized that our excitement about 3D, that's what messes us up, because in 3D it's too complicated. But in fact, what's happening is approximately 2D. What does it mean? So this is three orthogonal views of the cell, from above and from two sides. And you see that the cell is certainly three-dimensional, but from the side, in the Z direction, it's much narrower than in XY direction. What is even more important, if you look at individual trajectories of kinetochores and of the centrosomes, in Z direction, nothing interesting happens. They kind of stay at the same level, whatever. But in XY direction, that's interesting. And so as soon as we said, okay, forget about Z direction, let's do a 2D projection, then suddenly this machine learning started to tell us something interesting. Then we went and looked by eyes, and then we figured out what happened. And so basically, then the revelation came from the following. So we are measuring what's happening in this XY projection. And we're always tracking two centrosomes and trajectories of the chromosomes and kinetochores, right? And so what we have is trajectories of the centrosome in lab coordinate system and trajectories of the chromosome in lab coordinate system. And that was pretty complicated. Just with a human eye, we still couldn't figure it out. But that's where machine learning was very useful. It told us the following. So at the time, we were looking just at the centrosomes, at the chromosomes, not at the microtubules. So the unfortunate thing about microscopy that you cannot at the same time image kinetochores and centrosomes and microtubules. Then the cell get really boiled. But what you can do is track centrosomes and kinetochores for a while, then fix the cell, and then use electron microscopy to do microtubules. And then it turns out that there's always this oval shape of the developing mitotic spindle. And what this machine learning system did without us kind of thinking about it, it told us that stop looking at lab coordinate system, go to spindle coordinate system. If you go into system coordinate where the center of the spindle is fixed, then suddenly everything becomes much simpler. There's certain trick. Nowadays, you can do it in MATLAB because they actually uploaded this machine learning application to the MATLAB. It by itself will start, will tell you which coordinate system is best, the simplest. And so that's kind of the results I'll show you. So what are we actually measuring? So we measure. So if we go to the system coordinate that is the center of which stays with the center of the spindle, so then we know the distance between the two centrosomes. We know the position of the chromosome. We know the splay angle. We know the what we called C angle, or like distance between angle between vector between two kinetochores and spindle angle, right? We know the distance between two sister kinetochores. So that's kind of what we started measuring. And then the information is kind of like that. So these are trajectories of the centrosomes in lab coordinate system, and see they are complicated. The overall the centrosomes go away from each other and do some little dance. This is the trajectory of the one of the chromosomes, which is just too complicated to understand. Then if you go to the system of coordinates of the spindle, spindle poles just go away from each other along the straight line. This is the snapshot of the imagined spindle. So we took some electron microscope data, and from that we figured what's the most characteristic aspect ratio of this of the spindle, right? And so this specific spindle is at the time when a chromosome runs into the spindle. So originally, chromosome is far away from the spindle. Spindle is here, it's tiny. Then the spindle starts growing, right? Growing, 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 and chromosome is approaching the spindle. At this time, it runs into the spindle. And then it kind of does some dance in the spindle. The color coding here is another cool machine learning application. It decides if the chromosome does more drift or more diffusive motion. So diffusive means it does this, and drift means it does this, right? So it's always kind of like that. Originally, it's more drift, and then it's starting to do more and more diffusion.
The centrosomes start out next to each other because...
Sorry?
The centrosomes start out next to each other.
That's a great question. Not because they replicate. They actually starting at, so cell is sitting on the flat surface and it's kind of like fat pancake. The majority of the cell, 80% of them, one centrosome is near the ventral surface, another dorsal surface, at the opposite sides of this flattened nucleus. So they actually as far from each other around the nucleus as possible. And that's, so they separate in prophase from the time, like in the beginning of prophase, they're actually physically close. And then they separate really far. But then in 3D space, they're close because the nucleus is flattened in this.
When does the nuclear envelope break down?
At the end of prophase, when they're separated around the nuclear envelope.
Okay.
That's where we are starting. And that's kind of separate mystery, which we are starting to think about why centrosomes do this dance before. Then eventually we'll move like this. So that's the behavior. They start like this and move like that. Other than this, those movements, we trained computer to do is to follow distance between sister kinetochores. And it captures the stretches of the kinetochores. So the stretch normally means that the two kinetochores are captured from opposite poles and get pulled like this. But it's much more complicated than that because sometimes there are more than one stretch. And also we saw that even chromosomes captured improperly, they still get stretched. So this, you'll see later there's some mystery there. And also you can follow this angle between sister kinetochores and the spindle. And so when this angle becomes zero or pi, it means that chromosome is properly aligned with the spindle, also indicating that it's kind of captured. Right? And then you can also look at the distance between the centrosomes, which is increasing and then stabilizing, and what's chromosome doing in this coordinate system. And it's kind of this behavior that first it does something, it trembles, it moves, and then it gets yanked to the middle of the spindle and starts this sawtooth oscillations. And these sawtooth oscillations are very characteristic of the metaphase when the chromosome is properly captured. And the mystery is nobody quite knows what it means, but this is kind of a signature of properly captured chromosome. And that's also great for machine learning because rather than doing some Fourier transform and trying to catch this, you nowadays can tell any neural network, well, tell us which trajectories has this sawtooth and which doesn't. And it just does it with enormous accuracy. And so this is kind of very characteristic behavior. The chromosome for a while trembles, then it somehow gets captured and pulled directly to the center of the spindle, then bumps into the spindle, and then some complicated dance happens. What is very revealing in all this is the following. First of all, there's this two stages in life of the chromosome. Those are all the chromosomes, and trajectories are color-coded with cold color at the beginning and hot color at the end. So it first they all go centripetally to the center, and then they get on the spindle, and you see how they move. They always go along these arcs between the centrosomes. So they really just drift along the surface of this football-shaped spindle. Now, one key thing is that when you see when they physically move, and when during this time kinetochore distance is increasing, and there's a great correlation between time of hitting the spindle and time of interkinetochore stretch. So the stretch happens a certain average time after they hit the spindle. So this goes completely against the original philosophy of the search and capture mechanism. In search and capture, the actual spindle does not participate in it. You basically have this individual microtubules first making monotelic connection and then amphitelic connection. But here, it kind of suggests that there's no monotelic connections. The chromosome somehow goes to the spindle and then hits the spindle and immediately get oriented. So it kind of ruins the whole search and capture model. Also, all these connections made more or less at the same time. So you don't wait for last kinetochores to get connected after a very long time. They all pretty much connect at the same time. Also helps to think about it this way. This is this growing ellipse of the spindle. Those are individual chromosomes. So there's this rapid stage of convergence of them. Meanwhile, the spindle is growing. At some point, they're all over the spindle. And more or less at this point, all of them get connected properly. That's it. It doesn't show here, but it's about at this point all the kinetochore, interkinetochore stretches happening. And then they gradually get kind of from all over the spindle to the equator.
So they're all amphitelic connections?
They are pretty much all amphitelic, yeah. The way we cannot prove it, but well, I'll show you some data showing that they're all amphitelic. They're all interkinetochore stretch, and we have, I'll show you later, MAT2 signals that also showing kind of the same thing. So then, of course, what really helps is to look at both the control cells and perturbation. So in control, this is happening. So the spindle poles, the centrosomes, go away from each other, and this big cloud of the chromosomes, they don't really go anywhere in this projection. They just condense more and more to the center. Then there are two important molecular motors on the kinetochores. One of them is called PsenPe, so it's one of the kinesins, plus end motor. Another is Dynein, minus end motor. And there are certain molecular hypotheses of what these motors do. And what they do is organizing short microtubules that are hanging around the kinetochore. So SENPE is trying to organize them in certain geometric way. Without it, it's all disorganized. And Dynein does something else. So if you inhibit SENPE, see what's happening. Obviously, something bad. So there's some chromosomes that are at the equator, but lots of them go with the poles. And those cells actually never exit mitosis. So there's lots of the kinetochores there not even captured at all. If you inhibit Dynein, it's also something is bad, right? But those cells exit mitosis after a very long time. So they kind of make transient errors that later get corrected. And what is really weird, if you do double inhibition, then it's worse than only dynein, but much better than only SNPE. So those motors kind of do the something opposite, and it's getting better. So when we started to look at SNPE inhibited cells and looked at the trajectories, some of the trajectories behaved very similarly to the all the trajectories in the control cells. So they first kind of trembled, then moved to the spindle. They did something inside the spindle. The angle settled. The kinetic core gets stretched. This behavior is kind of similar. So later I'll show you the data showing that you cannot really distinguish this behavior from the behavior of the control cell. But some chromosomes behaved in a completely different bad way. So what's bad? Well, it starts fine. It trembles, get to the spindle, but then it left the spindle. It went with the pole away from the mitotic spindle. And so here you see, at some point, it seems like a chromosome is glued to the pole and goes with the pole. And then see the kinetic core, sister kinetic cores don't get stretched. The angles, though, settles in this case. Sometimes it doesn't, right? So the problem, though, by eye, like how do you say that this is different from the good behavior?
Is that a monotelic attachment?
Sorry?
Is it a monotelic?
That we don't know. We actually think that neither. It's lateral attachment of the chromosome to a microtubule. So what we are pretty much saying, there's no monotelic attachments at all. There's lateral attachment of the microtubule to the kinetic core. And there are tiny, tiny number of syntelic and meritelic attachments.
Usually the lateral attachments resolve themselves.
Right. I'll show you later. In the control cell, yes. And in this, all these perturbations, that's the problem. With SNPE, it can't.
It can't. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So are you saying like they're first lateral and suddenly?
And suddenly it's amphitelic, yeah. So this is the data, published data from our collaborators suggesting that bad behavior actually associates with chromosome being near the pole of the spindle. So there's a fluorescent signal from MAD2. And MAD2 on the chromosome means there's no end-on attachment. And so in control cells, all of them first have MAD2, then when they are, like, this is the time all the chromosomes are hitting the spindle, MAD2, and then pretty much at once all of them disappear. There are some very rare kinetic core, which is the last one, right? Then it disappears and the cell goes into anaphase. Okay? This is kind of classical data. If you inhibit SNPE, see what happens. It's kind of similar to control, but then some chromosomes that hang near the poles, they just keep having MAD2, they never get connected to the chromosomes, and the cell doesn't go into anaphase. So then what's happening with dynein-inhibited cells? Then again, some chromosomes have good behavior, so all the signatures, stretching, angle settling, gets on the spindle and stays on it. One thing what was very cool was this. Chromosomes normally get on the spindle when the spindle is pretty big. And I'll show you the data showing that this is not anecdotal. But some chromosomes are bad, meaning that they go with the pole, kind of, and there's no KT-KT stretch, angle doesn't settle, right? So again, the problem was, what do? You just, look at 1,000 trajectories and say something. So that's my point. We have to use this data science to start doing something quantitative automatically. Now, before I get to this data results, one striking thing visually. So this is control cell I already showed you. This is the Dannin inhibited cell. So one thing is very easy to see is this, that in Dannin inhibited, the chromosomes are not really getting much to the spindle. They wait for the spindle to get to them. It's like if prophet doesn't, if prophet doesn't go to the mountain, mountain goes to him, right? So this is like a mountain, and it comes to the chromosomes. So again, this is a departure from a classical search and capture model. You don't pull individual things to the center. Well, you wait for the center to come to you. But of course, in control, both things are happening. In Dannin inhibited cell, you more rely on this growing spindle. Okay. So this kind of start to tell you that the cell has this inventory of tricks. All of them are working to improve something. Now this is like what happens if you start to look at the big data. So those are sizes of the spindles at the times when chromosome hits the spindle. And so in control cells, most of the chromosome hit the spindle when the spindle is 60% of its maximal size. And it's similar in CNP inhibited spindle. But in Dannin inhibited spindles, a lot of chromosome hit the maximal spindle. So they just wait for the spindle to get big. And that makes sense because Dannin is minus end motor, so it moves chromosomes to the minus ends of the microtubules toward the spindle. And here the Dannin is inhibited, so it's harder to get chromosomes moving to the center. These are histograms for the time of the first movement. So remember, chromosomes were kind of moving randomly in space, and then at some point they latch onto something, boom, go to the spindle. In control cells, it's this. In CNP inhibited cells, it's faster. Why? Because probably CNP is plus end motor, it messes with Dannin. So Dannin maybe latches onto something, and then CNP tries to get it off. And in this Dannin inhibited, see how late it is. So chromosomes have trouble to start moving, and then they wait for the spindle to get to them. Now, that is a really cool stuff. So where do chromosomes get on the spindle? It turns out that in all conditions, majority of the chromosomes get right on the equator. They don't get on the pole, they get on the equator, where they're supposed to be. How could that be? So we ran some Monte Carlo simulations in which you start gathering chromosomes on microtubules coming from the poles, because pretty much all of them coming from the poles. Then you move this way, of course you get to the pole. How do you get to the equator, right? So the hypothesis we have is that chromosomes really move on at least two microtubules coming from opposite poles. And so it's like if I am, those are kinetochores, I am a chromosome, a rope comes from there, a rope comes from there, I start moving on both ropes and I get to the middle, right? This is complete guesswork. So what we are trying to do now is look at the electron micrographs trying to prove that there's this microtubules coming from opposite poles to the chromosome. Now, there's still lots of chromosomes hitting the poles, right? So the question is, does it really matter when you hit the spindle? Why does the cell even have to move chromosomes to the center? Why doesn't it wait for the spindle to keep increasing and getting everybody, right? There's very simple geometric answer. If you get onto the small spindle, even if you get on it near the pole, right, spindle keeps increasing. So, and the chromosomes, we noticed, they are not traveling much inside the spindle. So they get at some point and kind of stay there. So then it keeps increasing. You get automatically closer to the equator because the spindle normally grows symmetrically. Well, if you get on the spindle at the end near the pole, you'll stay near the pole. So it just suggests that I'll show you later why is it better. Well, it's kind of already clear. It's better to get there on the equator because chromosomes near the pole, they're bad. Near the equator, they're good. And so it helps to get onto the spindle early, then you're automatically near the pole. That's another interesting thing. So what we can easily get out of data, okay, you get onto the spindle, and then where do you move inside the spindle? I said that you kind of hang around, but you move a little bit. And so we can quantify movement of chromosome between this time and the end of our data. Does it move toward the equator? This is minus sign, or toward the pole? This is plus sign. And look at the data. In control, they do move on average to the equator. So many of them are on the equator, but some of them near the pole, and then you actively get corrected. You pull to the equator. In SEMP-E, it's totally screwed up. You actually mostly move to the poles. So there's something so bad about absence of plus-end motors that keeps you moving with the pole. And the simplest hypothesis is simple. Plus-end, so microtubules coming from the pole and growing this way. So most of the plus-ends are here. So plus-end motor moves you to the equator. Get rid of the plus-end motors, you stick with the pole. Or actually minus-end motor actually moves you to the pole. Now, this is very cool. You inhibit dynein, you move to the equator almost twice more than in control cell. Why? Because in this cells, you get to the spindle so late that you have to move a lot to get to the equator. And that's what is actually happening. But even that doesn't help completely, so there's still errors here. And so last thing, almost the last thing, is if you start plotting where you are in the spindle in the end. So zero is you're at the center of the spindle. This is great. One, you are really far off the center. This is bad. This is x-axis. Zero is you're at the center. This is bad. So this is control, all of them at the center. And this is when you get on the spindle. Zero is early, one is at the end of the process. So see, in control, well, there's some distribution when you get on the spindle, but it doesn't matter. You're always at the equator. In SEMP inhibited, you also distribute it. You get onto the spindle, a little bit earlier actually than here, but you totally screwed up in the end. And it doesn't matter when you get on the spindle. You have certain probability of getting screwed up. In dynein inhibited, there's correlation. You get onto the spindle early, you stay near the center. Late, you're screwed up. Okay. Kind of, again, supporting all the other data. So then, finally, we got really quantitative. We decided, okay, let us do the barcoding of the trajectories. So we measured, made computer to take out of the data all quantitative signatures of the trajectories that it could. And that's actually another thing machine learning helped us to identify all the quantifiers. It turned out there's about 10 quantifiers. Some of them are obvious, like, for example, oscillations in the end. Some of them were less obvious, trembling in the beginning, where chromosome ends, when it hits the ellipse, and on and on. So there's this data. And then the computer discretizes it. If it's greater than average, it's 1. It's less than average, it's 0. So each trajectory has a barcode made of zeros and 1s. Then you can do unsupervised clustering. Basically, you ask the computer, well, based on these barcodes, you can introduce trivial distance between the trajectories. And based on this distance, how do trajectories clusters? And remarkably, the clusters turned out to be good trajectories, bad trajectories. And bad, I kind of already explained to you what's bad about them, and good, also clear what's good about them. And it's kind of like good ones, and close to the middle of the spindle, bad ones far away. Good ones oscillate a lot in the in the end. Bad ones don't oscillate. Good ones tremble in the beginning. Bad ones don't tremble. That we don't understand molecularly, but it probably means that good ones, a lot of motors on the kinetic cores interact with long microtubules in the beginning, and there's this tug of war between motors. But who knows? That's one of the cool puzzles we are trying to solve now. What is very interesting is that probability to stretch, KT-KT stretch, is pretty much similar. It's bigger in for good ones, but not, but still big for bad ones. I'll tell you later why that probably is. And like aligning with the spindle, bigger probability here, but those, many of them also align. And then, the, of course, all this clustering is fraught with many, many caveats. One of the cool things you can do these days is check this so-called cofinetic correlation coefficient. It answers the following question. Okay, you have two clusters, but how similar trajectories in one cluster are to each other relative to the other cluster? And in this case, the answer is that all good trajectories are very similar, or bad trajectories are very similar. And this is interesting. So we have cells in very different biochemical conditions. But so what happens is this different biochemistry simply tells you that it just changes the frequency of certain behavior, but this behavior stays constant. And that's one of the cool puzzles we are trying to solve. It's not the continuum spectrum of behavior. It's really like two different behaviors. And then you can also do the supervised clustering to check if this unsupervised clustering makes sense. And there, what you really do, you have to train the computer. So you, by eye, you choose really obviously good trajectories and obviously bad, and tell computers that those are good, those are bad, and now cluster everything. And then it does, and the cool thing is that the resulting clustering is very, very similar to the unsupervised, which is a good sign. Let me skip all this stuff. Let me skip that. Let me just get to the kind of modeling that we do now. And I'm not showing any math. I'll just tell you qualitatively what we're doing. So the biggest puzzle now is this. One thing is that there's still some search and capture. So the spindle somehow get the chromosomes onto the central spindle in the beginning. And modeling there is very similar to what we did before. Just simulate microtubules going everywhere, grabbing chromosomes, pulling them closer. There's still some puzzles there because now we have good electron microscopy data showing that very few microtubules go away from the spindle. Most of them are inside the spindle. And so how those very few microtubules get everybody to the center pretty much synchronously is a puzzle. Our current hypothesis is that chromosomes piggyback on each other. So it's enough to get one out of 10 chromosomes. Others use short microtubules to find another chromosome, and like the whole clusters of chromosomes get to the center at once. We'll see if this works. But the real puzzle is, how come the chromosome get onto the central spindle and at once get amphitelically attached without all these transient stages fraught with errors? So we have two models that are not controversial. We're actually starting to get some preliminary data saying that they work at the same time. One of them is based on the following idea. So there are too many molecular details here, but basically the idea is this. There, this process of making connection, breaking connections. So the connections are very dynamic. Pavel actually did a very nice model many years ago, like with this pigment particles going on microtubule that also had this idea, but it's kind of the generic idea. Now, if you make this breaking of this connection force dependent, and so if you have greater force, it's harder to break a connection. Smaller force, it's easier to break a connection. This is very generic idea in cell biology that actually works in many cases. And some molecular motors have this so-called catch bonds that are like that. Pull on it, the connection is becoming tighter, release it, and connection breaks. And then this way, so there's growing understanding that when chromosomes are close to the central spindle, each kinetochore interacts with microtubules from opposite poles and interacts laterally. So in the beginning, in the sense, all of the connections are erroneous, but they are not undone. And then these connections are indiscriminatory, and it helps to get close to the spindle. But when you get close, you have to get rid of this connection and solidify that connection. And it's simply because those connections are pulling hard, and they survive. And those are not pulling, and they dissolve. Now, the problem with this model, though, it works like a charm, but it's very prone to errors. Okay, the one which is almost errorless is this. It's a very provocative model based on the data suggesting that most of the kinetochores, so remember this data that kinetochores originally are big. Not only the big, we are saying now that maybe in the beginning there's no two kinetochores, there's one giant kinetochore. It's not as simple as that. So kinetochore, as I said, is very complicated molecular assembly. It has inner layer and outer layer. So inner layer is much more defined and not dynamic. It's outer layer which is very dynamic. So inner stays just like those two buttons. But outer layer in prometaphase is this horseshoe which is covering both inner kinetochores. And then in the end, they're actually nice kinetochores. So what we are hypothesizing, that this outer layer, it's not solid. It's basically a very viscous fluid, like honey or molasses. And you get this indiscriminatory lateral connection with microtubules. And now Dynein starts to rip this kinetochore apart. And it's as simple as those microtubules get their own part of the honey. These microtubules, their own part. In the end, you have this. The beauty of it is that there's no chance to make an error. Okay. The caveat here is you actually have to interact with microtubules from opposite poles. If in the beginning you don't interact at all with microtubules from one pole, then neither model works. You're completely screwed up. And that's what we think is happening in all these inhibitions. The trouble with getting closer to the pole, that in the end, then you interact with just one polarity microtubules, and there's no recourse. But as I said, in most of these connections, with long time is getting repaired. So one of the future challenges, the future project, is to understand how do you rescue those guys. And one possibility is that it waits for, again, classical search and capture. You just wait for microtubule to get from here to there. This somehow we don't think is happening. There's something much more complicated than that. So that's one of the future challenges. So I think I gotta stop at this point. As you see, there's no definitive answers now, but it certainly takes this problem of spindle assembly to the new level. So all the modeling and data science is done by my postdoc, Chris Miles. He is absolutely remarkable. He started as a traditional applied mathematician, and then he realized that data science is the key these days and just learned it in a few months. And all the great data is coming from our collaborator lab, who is actually working in a really bizarre place, New York State Department of Health. I can tell you later, whoever is interested, lots of interesting anecdotes associated with this place. And experimental postdoc Fiorana is doing absolutely heroic work of actually tracking those kinetochores. Thank you.
Questions? With respect to the perturbation that would break up that pattern?
That's a great question. Yeah, so far we didn't see that. So like we have three, like dynein and pein double perturbation in all of them. What I didn't show is this. So orange is bad and this color is good. And so this is control, SNP, dynein inhibition, double inhibition, both two different types of clustering with 99% accuracy give this split. And there's no third kind. So what we can also do with all this data science tricks is to ask, okay, if we don't do two clusters, let's do three clusters, four clusters, five clusters, and then it's nothing interesting. So all these additional clusters are this weird in between cases. It's kind of like that. So these are the majority, and they're like three, four trajectories from about 1,000. So nothing interesting. So you can prove that really there are no third kind of behavior. And that's a great question. Like, what's the condition when we get some third behavior? Yeah.
So is it because currently the experiments either inhibit SNP or inhibit dynein? So what if some other?
Right, right. That's the question. What are the other perturbations that do everything something else? It wouldn't be
really just depends on the number of
markers. Yeah. Yeah, we don't know.
Alex, you didn't talk much about the mitotic checkpoint complex and the spindle assembly.
Yeah, yeah. So this is kind of not the focus of this project, but it's an interesting question. So it seems that the cell is certainly waiting for all the kinetochores to get attached. Yeah, yeah. So what's happening is in control cells, it's very clear. The cell is waiting until all the chromosomes are amphitelically attached. Then there's a very short period of this directional instability, and then they go to anaphase.
So how long does it take? I mean,
it's tens of seconds in control
just
cells.
Tens of seconds from when they hit the
From the last amphitelic attachment to the anaphase.
Okay, so that last stage happens quickly.
Very quickly, yeah.
Okay.
And it seems that the rate limiting, it would happen just in seconds, but for some reason the chromosome need to this directional instability, and this is complete puzzle. Like, why are they doing it? There's like vague suggestion that they try to correct errors, but there's no MAT2 anymore at this stage. So what errors are those? We don't know. But still, it's fast.
Okay, but it takes Zucker can tell us this. It takes some seconds.
It takes like order of half a minute to a minute.
The APC and
Yeah, and what we don't know is, like, which, what is longer? So there's obviously some mechanical thing happening, and then there's this reaction diffusion. We have no idea what are the characteristic rates and how it goes. Yeah, it just, like, we are cytoskeletal people. It like takes a totally complementary expertise to go to the cell cycle questions.
I'm trying desperately to connect your cytoskeleton story with the biochemistry story.
But I think it's really, there's no reason to mix them up. So what comes from this is that we can give you now we can give you the histogram for times of mechanical events, rather not mechanical events, but like kinetochore-centered events. And then I think the point is to take your models and like input is this as initial condition and see what's happening next. Part of the problem is that our collaborators and us, we like to work on these generic animal cells, which is kind of the top of complexity, while all the research on cell cycle is done on much simpler cells, which makes total sense. But the problem is that there's no the spindle and the mitosis. So this mitosis is way more complicated than, for example, yeast mitosis. No. Because they get NIH money relatively easily, but that's because they work on animal cells. Start work on yeast cells, and they. But it would be cool to kind of get it all together and see what's actually happening.
So in your model, it doesn't matter how many chromosomes you would have in the cell because they help each other to bring each other together.
That's a great question. No, so computational prediction so far that it matters a lot. And in the next year, actually, one of the high priority experiments. So you can actually do this kind of experiments on unreplicated cells. That absolutely bizarre. So there's kinetochore, but there's no actual chromosome. There's just DNA loops everywhere, right? And the cell does mitosis and divides like a charm. Of course, like pretty much all the connections are erroneous because you have like one kinetochore per chromosome. But you can also do sort of partial replication. So there's so you basically can regulate the number of proper chromosomes. So we are planning to look and see what happens. You also can blast with a laser. You can basically blast some of the chromosomes and see what happens.
So does this also indicate some kind of a gradual change of biochemical states in the cells? Of I don't know what that would be. Maybe some kind of change in cyclin B, CDK1 level that's kind of shifting the cell's behavior from one stage to another.
That's again, I think, related to John's questions. I have to plead complete ignorance. That's an important question, but I would say it's kind of the next level of complexity compared to simple mechanics that we do. Nobody knows. Our best forage into that, our collaborators have very good fluorescent markers for MAD2, so we really can say which kinetochores are end-on connected, which are not. Other than that, who knows?
Thank Alex for